For nearly 6 years, the Battle of the Atlantic would sprawl over 10.5 million square miles, the bulk of the action in its northern third. On its outcome rested the survival of the British Isles. In September 1939, Germany had 56 U-boats, of which 10 were non-operational, and only 22 capable of fighting in the Atlantic. Convoys of merchant ships had overcome the U-boat menace in the First World War. A new underwater detection device known as ASDIC, after its developer, the Anti-Submarine Investigation Committee, and more effective depth charges with multiple settings had since enhanced the power of naval escorts. There was little to fear from the U-boat, it seemed. Powerful German surface vessels were of more concern. The illusion of a toothless U-boat arm was rapidly and brutally shattered. Within hours of war being declared, the liner Athenia was torpedoed, and in 6 weeks, U-boats had sunk the aircraft carrier Courageous and battleship Royal Oak.
Even though a number of sinkings had taken place in the Atlantic during the first month of the war, the U-boat menace was not clear to everybody. That all changed in the early hours of the 14th of October, when U-boat 47 crept into the anchorage at Scarpa Flow and sank the battleship Royal Oak. ...833 men were lost in 15 minutes. The shock to both the public and military opinion was such that U-boat menace was never underrated again.
17 ocean-going U-boats operating in the Atlantic were soon attacking merchant ships. The convoy system was not foolproof. It steamed at the speed of its slowest vessel, and frequently foul weather scattered the orderly columns. Even in good conditions, convoy discipline could be thwarted by ships straying out of line or pouring smoke and sparks from their funnels at night. Furthermore, until August 1940, when slow convoys were introduced, ships making fewer than 9 knots sailed independently. In 1939, the Royal Navy could provide only an average of 2 escorts per convoy, none able to sail more than 500 miles west of Britain, after which the ships were on their own. 15 Group Coastal Command had aerial responsibility for the Atlantic, but its 5 squadrons of land-based aircraft and flying boats lacked the range or capability to compensate for the naval weakness.
In 1939, Coastal Command did not have the attention which was given to Bomber Command and Fighter Command. It therefore had to make do with a variety of aircraft, and not in very great numbers. It had, for example, the Anson, the Hudson, the Wellington and the Whitley. In terms of flying boats, it had the Sunderland, the Stranraer and the London. And its only torpedo bomber was the obsolescent Wildebeest. It was so pressed for aircraft that for the first 9 months of the war, it even deployed biplane Tiger Moths and Hornets to do coastal patrols.
The Admiralty had been right to fear the enemy's array of large warships. Grand Admiral Erich Raeder, Commander-in-Chief of the German Navy, recognized that, if used as surface raiders, his capital ships could cause mayhem. During August 1939, The pocket battleships Admiral Graf Spee and Deutschland, later renamed Lützow, slipped into the Atlantic. After sinking 9 merchantmen in 4 months, Graf Spee was cornered by a Royal Navy squadron in the River Plate and scuttled by her crew. A seaplane catapulted from Ajax reported on the fall of shells during the action. At the close of 1939 in the Atlantic, German surface ships had sunk 15 merchantmen and 1 armed merchant cruiser. U-boats 114 merchant ships. This was only the prelude to even more testing times. Due to the requirements of the Norwegian campaign from April to May 1940, the home fleet had to be kept in the North Sea to guard against further excursions by enemy warships, flotillas to defend the coastline against invasion, and counter E-boats in the channel. By the summer of 1940, the average number of warship escorts with an Atlantic convoy had dropped to 1.8.
In the early part of the Second World War, there was lack of escorts, and that's when we lost so many. We didn't see them. If we could see them, we would destroy them. But we'd get information to say there could be a big pack that was following the convoy. And you couldn't do anything until you picked them up.
The first 5 months of 1940 was deceptively quiet in the Atlantic, partly due to poor weather and partly to withdrawal of U-boats for the Danish and Norwegian campaigns. During January and February, 85 ships were lost. March to May, only 43. In June, though, the U-boats were back with a vengeance to account for 58 merchant ships. Between July and October, they sank another 217. U-boat commanders had learned to vary their tactics. At first, they repeated the First World War approach of striking from beneath the surface, where sighting a convoy was largely a matter of chance. On the surface, though, a U-boat could manage almost 20 knots, and astute captains realized that they could stalk and attack a convoy at night with relative ease. Formation of coastal convoys guarded by armed trawlers of the Royal Navy Patrol Service brought more success. For a merchant ship's journey had not ended when it crossed the Atlantic. It must then make its way round the coast to its final destination, at the mercy of mines, U-boats, and enemy aircraft.
I had Beleitzüge angegriffen im Mittelmeer innerhalb des Kampfgeschwaders 77. Als das zusammengeschlagen wurde im Mittelmeer und bei der Invasion, sind aus 2 Geschwadern 1 gemacht worden und ich gehörte dann zu dem einzigen noch vorhandenen Torpedogeschwader 26. Wir haben die Geleite angegriffen, die Material aus England und Amerika an die Ostfront, also an unsere Ostfront gebracht haben, zur Unterstützung der Russen und deswegen waren wir auch von der Wichtigkeit dieser Bekämpfung überzeugt. Wir haben überhaupt auf niemanden geschossen, außer dass wir mal, wenn wir nah an einem Flugzeug, an einem Schiff vorbeigeflogen sind, mit unseren leichten, lächerlichen Bordwaffen uns selbst beruhigt hatten, indem wir da Schüsse aufgegeben haben. Aber wir hatten die Aufgabe, Torpedos zu schmeißen. Diese Torpedos laufen im Wasser und sollten die Schiffe treffen und sollten sie in die Luft sprengen.
In the closing months of 1940, the Wolf Pack, when a group of U-boats converged on a convoy, began to pose a new danger. In September, successive convoys were attacked northwest of Iceland by 10 U-boats, which sank 16 ships. During the 16th and 17th of October, convoy SC-7 from Nova Scotia came under attack from 7 U-boats. Of its 35 merchantmen, only 15 survived, despite daylight cover from Coastal Command Sunderland circling overhead. The surrender of France in June 1940 opened up bases on the Atlantic coast for warships and submarines. U-boats could now spend most of their time at sea, astride the convoy routes beyond the range of British escorts. Western France also provided the Luftwaffe with valuable bases. Despite their limited capabilities, British aircraft did contribute to the defense of convoys. In January 1940, convoy OA-80 lost two ships to U-55, but its escorts and a Sunderland flying boat so harassed and damaged the U-boat that its commander scuttled it.
I wouldn't know how much, but I know we had air cover. Yes, I must say, the fleet air arm, they were wonderful, yes. And even the, what we call the little carriers, yeah, they were sent out as observers picking up U-boats. Yes, they were great help.
Anti-submarine sweeps were mounted from bases in Cornwall, Wales and Northern Ireland over the Bay of Biscay and as far into the Atlantic as possible. Occasionally, they did sight a U-boat on the surface going to and from its lair, and even more occasionally managed to attack it before the inevitable crash dive.
We used to sweep for them, what they call sweep for them, and check them out to see if we could pick any of them up before they come into the convoy. And had every success. When you think 23 U-boats were sunk in 21 months. So it just showed you how efficient the escort was. But you couldn't save all of them. It'd been awful for us when we've seen them blown up inside, when they've got inside, not been detected. And that was a terrible shame. The terrible thing is to see them go up and can't do anything about it.
The Germans, on the other hand, had the Focke Wulf Condor, with an operational range of 800 miles into the Atlantic, far beyond that of existing convoy escorts. Apart from spotting convoys for the Wolf packs, the Condors attacked vulnerable targets with their own 1,750-kilogram bomb load. During 1940, they accounted for 11 ships, besides damaging the liner Empress of India, which was finished off by a U-boat. In the final 3 months of 1940, German warships once more broke into the Atlantic. On the 27th of October, the third pocket battleship, Admiral Scheer, left Germany to evade all air and sea patrols. After sinking a merchant ship on the 5th of November, she intercepted a convoy protected by a single armed merchant cruiser, Jervis Bay, whose six guns were totally outranged. Nevertheless, she sacrificed herself to save the convoy, only five of which were eventually caught by the German warship. By the end of 1940, the second phase of German warship activity in the Atlantic had accounted for 17 ships. In total, during 1940, 1,059 merchant ships were sunk in the Atlantic. The 22 million tons of food reaching Britain pre-war had dwindled by almost 50%. There were bright spots, though. After the fall of Denmark in April, British forces occupied the Danish dependencies of the Faroe Islands and Iceland, commanding the northern approaches to the Atlantic. 5 months later, in return for leasing military bases in Newfoundland and the West Indies, the United States made 50 elderly destroyers available to Britain, which would ease the escort shortfall. Furthermore, RAF Bomber Command began to attack the U-boat pens and indirectly aid the Atlantic battle by striking at plants producing synthetic oil in Germany. As 1941 opened, the threat of sea invasion of the British Isles may have faded, but Allied planners knew that the U-boat construction program had yet to peak. Nor had the Condor threat diminished. In February 1941, six attacked a convoy from Gibraltar, sinking five ships. As U-boats accounted for 60 merchant ships in January and February, the Condors sank 47. Junker Ju-88s and Heinkel HE-111 bombers flying from French bases had begun to pose serious problems as well.
Eine U-88. Das ist ein zweimotoriges Flugzeug. Das war so das Arbeitstier der deutschen Luftwaffe. Die gab es als Zerstörer, als Nachtjäger, als Bomber, als Sturzkampfbomber und eben auch als Torpedoflugzeug. Na, also Beobachter hatte ich und dann hatte ich den Funker und den Bordschützen. Wir beiden, der Beobachter und ich, wir guckten nach vorne und Rücken an Rücken zu uns saßen die beiden anderen und die hatten jeder ein mittleres Maschinengewehr, 13 mm, zum Teil mit Zerlegermunition und schossen nach hinten und hatten die Aufgabe, uns vor feindlichen Jägern zu warnen und diese im Notfall auch zu bekämpfen.
In March, the American Lend-Lease Bill eased equipment shortages. The following month, Iceland became fully operational as a base for ships and aircraft, as more bases along the Canadian coast came into service. In July, the US Navy agreed to undertake limited convoy duties in the Western Atlantic. Encouragingly too, the government code and cipher school at Bletchley Park had begun regularly to crack the German naval code, allowing it to eavesdrop on transmissions to the U-boats. In an attempt to improve the aerial cover of convoys, the CAM, Catapult Aircraft Merchant Ship, appeared. During 1941, five came into service, one being lost before seeing action. Each carried a single Sea Hurricane or Fulmar aircraft, manned by a Fleet Air Arm pilot.
A CAM ship was a catapult aircraft merchantman, which carried a catapult which was able to launch a single Hurricane or Fulmar aircraft which it carried. Unlike a seaplane, which was carried by a battleship or a cruiser, this could not be recovered and could therefore only be used once. The pilot crash-landed on the sea or parachuted to safety. He was saved, but the aircraft wasn't.
In September 1941, another initiative, the MAC, Merchant Ship Aircraft Carrier, came into service. HMS Audacity, a merchantman hull with a flight deck, carried six Grumman Wildcat fighters, called Martlet by the British, which, unlike the catapult aircraft, could land again. The fighters accounted for one Condor before Audacity was torpedoed on convoy duty in December, but other MACs would follow it into action. During 1941, aircraft could fly 700 miles into the Atlantic from Canada, Northern Ireland and the west coast of Scotland, 400 miles from Iceland. Not only was the so-called air gap extensive, but due to lack of suitable aircraft, even the existing air cover was patchy. A gleam of hope had appeared, though, with 10 reconnaissance versions of the B-24 Liberator available for Coastal Command. In time, this aircraft would be a crucial acquisition. So would the Catalina flying boat, which reached the RAF in March 1941.
The American consolidated Catalina flying boat began to reach Coastal Command in numbers in March 1941 in time for the Bismarck operation. Over 650 Catalinas would serve with the RAF during the Second World War. She had a speed of 185 miles per hour and an enormous range of 3,750 miles. She had the ability to drop both bombs and depth charges and, like the Sunderland flying boat, was credited with attacking a large number of U-boats during the course of the Battle of the Atlantic.
Alarmingly, the German battleship Bismarck passed through the Skagerrak Strait between Denmark and Sweden on the 20th of May 1941. Reconnaissance aircraft from British bases quickly began to scour the Norwegian coastline for her. Next day, a Coastal Command pilot discovered Bismarck in a fjord near Bergen in southern Norway. On the 22nd of May, six Whitley and six Hudson bombers of RAF Coastal Command vainly tried to find the fjord in poor weather. That evening, through a break in the clouds, a Fleet Air Arm aircraft found the anchorage empty. Bismarck was on the loose.
The Bismarck was described by the Soviet commander of the Northern Fleet as a large floating fortress, far greater capacity than the pocket battleship Admiral Spey, which caused such a problem in the South Atlantic in 1939. Fully laden, she was 52,000 tons with a crew of 2,300. Her speed was 28 knots, but at times she was credited with doing 34 knots and therefore was considerably faster than some of the destroyers. Her main armor were 8 15-inch guns, and her secondary armor was 5.9-inch guns. She was therefore a considerable menace when she got out into the Atlantic.
In poor visibility throughout the 23rd of May, relays of Sunderland's, Catalina's and Hudson's searched the Norwegian coast and northern approaches to the Atlantic without success. Then in a snowstorm at dusk, the cruiser Suffolk finally sighted Bismarck and the heavy cruiser Prince Eugen sailing through the Denmark Strait between Iceland and Greenland. Using radar, Suffolk kept track of the German warships during the night, at dawn being joined by a Hudson and a Sunderland. Meanwhile, the battleship Prince of Wales and battle cruiser Hood were on course to intercept the enemy at dawn on the 24th of May. The Sunderland reported what happened when the four ships clashed. Hood was sunk, and Prince of Wales withdrew under smoke, though not before a shell had damaged fuel lines on Bismarck. Later that afternoon, the German ships parted. Prince Eugen sailed on into the Atlantic. The battleship decided to make for Saint-Nazaire on the French Atlantic coast for repairs. At 3 a.m. on the 25th of May, all contact with Bismarck was lost. The Admiralty reasoned that she would either turn back or make for France. Catalina's, flying for over 20 hours, unsuccessfully searched throughout the day and the night of the 25th to the 26th of May. The British then had a stroke of luck. Admiral Gunther Lütjens sent a long radio message to Berlin announcing the sinking of Hood, and direction-finding equipment pinpointed Bismarck's position. A separate message between Berlin and Athens was deciphered by Bletchley Park, and the German battleship's intended destination revealed. The race was now on to catch Bismarck before she could reach the haven of land-based air cover in the Bay of Biscay. The aircraft carrier Ark Royal was already steaming north from Gibraltar to join the hunt. During the afternoon of the 26th of May, she launched Swordfish torpedo bombers in heavy seas and poor visibility. They located a lone warship and duly attacked, and two of the 13 torpedoes struck Bismarck. One fatally hit the steering gear, and throughout that night, the stricken vessel steamed in circles. The following morning, the 27th of May, the Royal Navy finished her off. Aerial activity throughout the chase had been decisive. Without it, Bismarck would have reached Saint-Nazaire and lived to menace the Atlantic convoys.
The two-seater ferry Swordfish was a remarkable aircraft. It came into service in 1936 and served for the greater part of the war. It had the capacity to carry a 1,610-pound torpedo, or the equivalent in mines or bombs. It had a speed of 138 knots, which is extremely slow, but it made it an effective torpedo bomber, as was shown when it was engaged in the Bismarck operation.
Acutely aware of the threat to fuel supplies, which could quickly undermine the whole war effort, On the 9th of March 1941, Winston Churchill declared, "We must take the offensive against the U-boat and the Focke-Wulf." Entry of the United States into the war in December 1941 gave the U-boats a fruitful, happy time off its eastern seaboard. During the night of the 13th and 14th of January 1942, U-123 picked off two tankers silhouetted against the well-lit New York skyline. 3 days later, 375 miles south off Cape Hatteras, the same U-boat sank a freighter and tanker. American merchantmen were still sailing with full lights, encouraging another 20 U-boats to converge on the American coast. In January 1942 alone, 40 ships were sunk in the Western Atlantic. And the following month, the U-boats moved south to Florida, where they continued to enjoy success. At length, in March 1942, the Americans began to introduce the convoy system. And by July, losses off the East Coast had fallen to just three. By then, U-boats had claimed 505 merchant ships.
We were torpedoed at 6:40 in the morning. And we had two torpedoes and completely cut kite in half. And we sank in 55 seconds. I ran up the hatchway and the bulkhead door, fortunately, was open. And I never, you never have the bulkhead door open when you're closed up and on duty. So thank God it saved me. I swam to an oar, and already there were three sailors hanging onto it. And I watched one go down after a while. Then I saw the other one go down after a while. And then it came, I said to a fellow that was right, we were so close, we could touch each other easy. And I said, I can't do anymore. And he said, don't let go, he said. Here's the Keppel now coming in to pick us up. And I looked to see the Keppel. And I said, that was the last word he spoke. He went. There were 14 of us picked up and five died abroad. And that was it. They claimed that the U-boat was sunk by swordfish a couple of hours after.
During 1942, Admiral Karl Dönitz, commander of the U-boat arm, had calculated that 800,000 tons of Allied shipping sunk every month would secure victory. The Germans achieved approximately 650,000. This may not have secured Dönitz's instant triumph, but did put the brake on troop reinforcements across the Atlantic. Scarcely one of the expected five Canadian and American divisions reached England. A powerful element in the Allied response began to attack the Atlantic coast ports, when on the 21st of October, 24 B-24 bombers of the US 8th Army Air Force took off from their English bases for Lorient. Before the year was out, in nine further raids, another 243 B-17s and B-24s would leave their airfields for that submarine base, 68 others for Brest, 176 Saint-Nazaire, and 31 La Palisse.
The United States entered the war committed to daylight raids with heavy bombers. When the 8th Army Air Force reached England in 1942, they had the B-17, which could fly at 317 miles per hour at 25,000 feet and carry a bomb load of 5,000 pounds, and the B-24, which could fly at 300 miles per hour at 25,000 feet and could carry a bomb load of 8,000 pounds. Both aircraft had a range of 2,000 miles.
With easy pickings no longer available in the Western Atlantic, Dönitz decided to exploit the area south of Greenland, which could not be covered by land-based aircraft and had been nicknamed Torpedo Junction by disenchanted merchant crews. By early 1943, an estimated 112 of the 240 available U-boats were operational in the Atlantic, and the Wolf Pack was in the dangerous ascendancy. The critical period in the whole battle had arrived. The more so because November 1942 to April 1943, the British escort carriers and support groups were redeployed to guard convoys reinforcing the American landings in North Africa. During these weeks, there was some success for aircraft. On the 9th of February 1943, a Catalina from 202 Squadron located and drove a U-boat below the surface. On the 25th of March, a Flying Fortress of 206 Squadron sank U-489. And shortly afterwards, two Sunderlands from 461 Squadron accounted for U-106.
Wir hatten es mit Flugzeugen zu tun von den Flugzeugträgern und da waren es erstmal die Swordfish. Das ist so ein uralter Doppeldecker, der aber mit geringer Landegeschwindigkeit sich gut für Flugzeugträger eignete und mit dem erstaunliche Erfolge gegen U-Boote erzielt worden sind. Wir selbst als angreifende Flugzeuge wurden am meisten behagt von den Wildcats. Das waren amerikanische Yachtflugzeuge, die gerade eben noch langsam genug waren in der Landung, um auf diesen Flugzeugträgern auch wirklich landen und starten zu können. Da ist das Gesichtsfeld ziemlich eingeengt und man kämpft um sein Leben. Man macht Abwehrbewegungen höher, tiefer und nochmal nach links, nochmal nach rechts. Bei einer solcher Bewegung habe ich eine Wasserberührung bei der Bäreninsel gekriegt und bin nur mit Mühe und Not nach Hause gekommen, weil mir von meinem Propeller so viel weggeflogen war, dass der Motor wahnsinnig schüttelte und wir immer nur hoffen konnten, dass er noch hält und nicht rausbricht.
During March 1943, 120 ships were sunk. And the Admiralty admitted, the Germans never came so near to disrupting communications between the New World and the Old. March 1943 would be the darkest hour. After that, as the escort carriers and support groups returned to the North Atlantic from Africa, the tide began to turn. Positive steps were taken finally to close the dangerous air gap in mid-Atlantic. During April 1943, 41 Liberators with extended range were in service. Operating from Northern Ireland, Iceland and Newfoundland, they could now cover all the convoy routes. In April 1943, three new escort carriers, each with 18 to 24 aircraft, entered the Atlantic fray. Before the year closed, another 28 would be in service, though only a few would fight in the Atlantic. Between the 28th of April and the 6th of May, an eastbound convoy, ONS-5, aided by two support groups and long-range aircraft, fought off 42 U-boats in an encounter which Admiral Sir Max Horton, Commander-in-Chief of the Western Approaches, hoped signaled a turning point in the Battle of the Atlantic. The U-boats accounted for 12 merchantmen, but suffered 6 losses themselves, one sunk by a flying boat, with 12 more seriously damaged. During April 1943, the U-boat sank 245,000 tons, but lost 15 of their number. In May, the tonnage dropped to 165,000 tons at a cost of 40 U-boats. In June, the figures were 18,000 tons and 17 U-boats. Faced with these losses, Dönitz withdrew most of his U-boats into the Bay of Biscay, from which, with improved homing torpedoes, better radar, and within range of land-based fighters, they could operate more securely. With many of the Allied escorts covering the Normandy landings, in July, U-boats sank 123,000 tons of shipping. The Germans set a trap for unwary air crews. When large U-boats equipped with two quadruple 20mm and one 37mm anti-aircraft guns remained on the surface during daylight. That subterfuge was abandoned after a flight of bow fighters demolished U-441 on the 12th of July, 1943. In autumn 1943, wolf packs briefly returned to the Atlantic. On the 19th of September, two convoys were intercepted by 19 U-boats south of Iceland. A support group sped to their aid. Although three escorts and six merchantmen were lost, the attackers were dispersed with the loss of two U-boats, one sunk by a homing torpedo dropped from a Liberator, and two severely damaged. During October, the Allies began to regain the initiative. Convoy SC-143 lost just two ships against three U-boats sunk. During that month, a total of 23 U-boats were sunk. Heavy bombers had been specifically directed to provide direct support for the anti-U-boat campaign in 1943. Following the Allied Casablanca Conference in January, the British American Air Forces were to attack submarine pens, construction yards, and production factories as part of the combined bomber offensive. So between the 14th of January and the 6th of April, RAF Bomber Command flew 3,170 sorties against Saint-Nazaire and Lorient. And during the year, 1,135 American heavy bombers left their English bases for Brest, Lorient, Saint-Nazaire, and La Palisse.
In January 1943, the American 8th Army Air Force began to bomb Germany from England, and it was necessary to coordinate its effort with that of the Royal Air Force. At an Allied conference in Casablanca in January 1943, the outline of the combined bomber offensive against Germany was therefore drawn up. The aim was the progressive destruction and dislocation of German industry, and in particular to attack the aircraft industry and the submarine construction industry.
Yeah, well, it was just normal daylight raids on the Channel coast. They were all down at Le Havre, Brest and other places down the Channel there. And they were very fiercely defended, as I say, by flak. But they had to get very close, and it's a bit frightening in a way, I suppose, when you see these puffs of smoke off the wingtip and they go boom, 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 a regular pattern.
The main bombing effort, though, was concentrated on Germany, where the method of U-boat construction had changed. Hitherto, hulls had been built in dockyards, engines and other components transported to be fitted there. Now new hulls were prefabricated at inland factories and assembled at the ports, making the bombers' task more difficult. Nevertheless, in 1943, Allied bombing effectively destroyed 30 U-boats before they could be assembled. Despite the serious setbacks suffered in the latter part of 1943, the U-boats were not yet finished. Focke-Wulf Condors reappeared to identify targets, and in November were joined by four-engine Ju-290s and six-engine Blommenvoss flying boats in a desperate attempt to stem the flow of American troops and supplies heading eastwards across the Atlantic.
Es gab ja Luftaufklärung und wir wussten ziemlich genau, wie groß die Geleite waren, und das waren die 20 bis 30 Handelsschiffe oftmals und dann vielleicht 10 Zerstörer, manchmal auch 15 Zerstörer oder Fregatten oder Korvetten, also kleinere Schiffe, und ein bis zwei Flugzeugträger. Das wussten wir ziemlich genau, was uns da erwartete. Ja, die sind so etwa alle 14 Tage bis drei Wochen ist so ein Geleit in die eine Richtung gekommen, und natürlich dann nach drei Tagen oder fünf Tagen Liegezeit in Murmansk kamen die wieder zurück und wurden dann, wenn sie noch in unserer Reichweite waren, auch wieder angegriffen. Aber unser Hauptaugenmerk waren natürlich die Geleite, die nach Murmansk voll mit Flugzeugen und Panzern und Artillerie, Munition und Kanonen mit allem Kriegsgerät beladen waren. Denn natürlich ist es wirkungsvoller, wenn man ein vollbeladenes Schiff versenkt, als wenn man ein leer zurückkommendes versenkt.
There was therefore still considerable work for aircraft to do. On the 10th of March 1944, a Sunderland from 422 Squadron sank U-625, and on the 8th of July, two Sunderlands from the Royal Australian Air Force's 10 Squadron combined with a Liberator from 105 Squadron to dispatch U-243. During 1944, five more escort carriers would reach the Royal Navy, and the last of a smaller class of close support carrier, sailing in the convoys rather than escorting them, came into service. In 1944, however, a new invention helped the U-boats. Fitting of a snorkel air-breathing device to their engines allowed them to remain below the surface for long periods to evade air detection. For a time, this looked like a very dangerous development.
The Type 21 U-boat came into service in 1941 with the snorkel breathing device, which enabled submarines to use their diesel engines underwater. This meant that they could achieve a speed of something like 16 knots, which had not been possible before. The Type 21 boats had 18 torpedo tubes and a crew of 57, and they were most effective. Had they come into operation a year earlier, the Battle of the Atlantic may have taken a different course and been much longer.
Allied bombers continued to attack the Atlantic ports. In 1944, the Americans flew 952 sorties against Brest and La Palisse. But by the end of 1944, all the German Atlantic coast ports, with the stubborn exception of Lorient, had fallen. There was a dramatic success, too. In November 1944, RAF Lancaster bombers finally dispatched the last of Germany's big ships, Tirpitz, at anchor near Tromsø in Norway.
The battleship Tirpitz was the sister ship of the Bismarck, which had caused so much trouble to the Allies in the Atlantic in May 1941. Between May 1940 and November 1944, 700 British aircraft, either the RAF or the Fleet Air Arm, had attempted to mine, bomb or torpedo her in 33 separate raids. The fear was that she would break out into the Atlantic like the Bismarck. And to guard against that, the Navy also held a very strong force in Scapa Flow, aircraft carriers, battleships, cruisers, destroyers. So when Tirpitz was sunk in November 1944 in a Norwegian field, it not only removed a threat to the convoys in the Atlantic, but also allowed the Royal Navy to disperse the ships which they had kept at Scapa Flow and send them on other duties throughout the world.
Saw her quite clearly, 30 miles away, lying there. Gathered the bomber around, got a marvellous run on it, I did. And just at that, we just got the critical point, and the bomber said, "God, Christ," he said, "clouds come over the target." And I said to him, "What sort of run have we had, Arthur?" "Oh, perfect, absolutely perfect." So I said, "Well, let the bomb go then." And the bomb went off on its own. And then it cleared again. And the bomber, they shout, "God, we've sunk it." 10 minutes it took. And as I say, a lot of men inside it, about 1,000 men went. That was good position bombing, that was.
During the Battle of the Atlantic, U-boats sank 2,603 merchant ships and 175 escort vessels. Over 30,000 sailors were lost. On the other hand, 784 from the 1,162 U-boats in service had been sunk. Air power had made a major contribution to Allied success. Introduction of the long-range reconnaissance machines, notably the Liberator, did much to sway the balance. The short-lived catapult ships had pointed the way to better close cover for convoys, Production of escort carriers and dual-purpose MAC merchantmen proved critical. Post-war, the British Bombing Survey Unit concluded that in Germany, heavy bombers had destroyed 111 potential U-boats in the construction process. Until mid-1943, the U-boats undoubtedly held the upper hand. In the words of the Duke of Wellington after the Battle of Waterloo, for nearly 4 years, it had been a damn close-run thing.
Zum Teil intelligentere, denn die technischen Überlegenheiten der Engländer und Amerikaner waren ja frappant. Hatten natürlich auch andere Möglichkeiten, die großartigen Ideen der technischen Waffen besser zu produzieren und auszunutzen. Und wir haben dann ziemlich schnell gemerkt, dass es verdammt tapfere Leute auf der anderen Seite gibt. Und sodass ich das Gefühl einer Überlegenheit schon deswegen nicht mehr haben konnte im Jahr 44, 45, weil unsere Flugzeuge unterlegen waren, weil unsere Materialien wie die Motoren unterlegen waren. Wir flogen ja praktisch mit den Flugzeugen, die im Jahr 1937 entwickelt worden sind und dann nicht besser geworden sind, sondern immer nur schwerer, weil mehr Panzerung rein musste und mehr Bewaffnung rein musste. Und ein Gefühl der Überlegenheit hat sich wahrscheinlich nur in den ersten Kriegsjahren, als wir noch erfolgreich waren, einstellen können. Zu meiner Zeit war eher das Gegenteil der Fall.
I was 19 when I volunteered to go in the Navy. Young, wasn't nervous, just doing a job, a good job, and we came out very successful. But in all that, a lot of lives were lost with the U-boats. You know, it was something we had to do, but when you reflect back on it, you think, what a waste of lives. Something we couldn't avoid. Yes, I'm glad, I'm proud to do my bit, but awful.